Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm going to show you how to work and deploy ML applications with Google APP Engine. What is Google APP Engine? It's a service in Google Cloud that provides end-to-end application management. It will allow us to create to quickly and easily deploy an application that we build locally in our local environment, also integrated in a CI/CD pipeline. It's fully integrated with several of these technologies. And the service is fully managed by Google, and then you only need to care about deciding well the infrastructure that you want to use to run your application, and the language. Well, that is already decided because you already create the application, and well, decide the runtime and the infrastructure sizes and how you want to scale the applications once in case that there is a need to do that. No scale either horizontally or vertically the application. So I will start with a little bit of description. What is the application? Well, I'm assuming that you had a number of things to run this tutorial. This what I'm going to explain you in this video. You need to have an account in Google ready to go, so you had access to the Google dashboard, so you had access to this. You have the APP Engine API activated, and you also had a service account created. Now you need this to essentially access to other services inside the Google Cloud, and also it is the identity that the application is going to use to run. And access to other services in the cloud. So these three things are important, and then you need to have them before going to the setup of the application that we will speak a little bit later. So the APP Engine is essentially the setup, the easiest. Setup is a container which contain a resource, and this resource is named application, and this application is the container which contain different services. These services you can associate with applications, with what we know an application that you are developing and keeping in a repository, or the thing that the stuff you are going to deploy for a purpose into this service, into this endpoint. And this service can be it could be different versions of the same service, okay? And these different versions can run in one or multiple instances of different types, no? This is the top-down description of how the APP Engine service works, no? You define an application. Inside the application, you can define multiple services. This is multiple endpoints for multiple purposes. And then on every service has multiple versions, and every version can be running in different infrastructure templates, no? And also there is a two types of environments that you can choose to run the different versions of your instance. The instance itself is just not more than a container, a Docker container, which is a description of an infrastructure, meaning that is a server with some characteristics, memory, CPU, hard disk, etc. And a language, development language, could be one of these you have here: Go, PHP, Java, Python, Node, Ruby, or .NET. And it, depending, you choose the flexible environment, you can personalize the container, the Docker in this case, with any other language apart of that. We will look at this later on, and the definition of the networking, firewalling, load balancing, and so on and so forth. If you don't specify all these details, Google will take the defaults, and then you need just to deploy. The easiest way to deploy this is just specifying a couple of two, three lines in a YAML file or in a JSON file of configuration, and just deploy the software into an endpoint. Later on, this to start with is the easiest way. Two, three lines of the configuration in a file, and you can deploy. Obviously, we will cover later on how this looks like. The configuration file is much more complete than that, and there is the configuration file for any of these languages that you had available, and also for the custom one that we will cover later on as well. And again, in few words, this is the how is organized the service. If you want to run to have another application, you need a second service account. So inside your project in Google Cloud, you can have multiple service accounts. Every service account is attached to an application, and then on this, that is the way to you have multiple applications with multiple services and multiple versions and so on and so forth. In my opinion, you probably don't need that. It's probably more than enough to just have, unless that you are working in multiple regions and you have to you have a very complex organization, and then that will be the case that every region, but at the same time in every region can have different applications or different views of the Google Cloud account. So this is quite complex. It had a lot of flexibility, this organization. So most of the scenarios are covered with a single application and multiple services that expose multiple functionalities that you may need to expose to your users. You can I will give you later into the description of the video the link to the repository where I used to upload all what I do and explain in my videos. And then let's move now. So we cover as well languages. The four languages, you can write an application in any of these languages that you see here. And if you have a specific requirement that is not covered in with these languages, which is, could be really specific, no? Or you need to do a specific installation of the runtime environment, so you need something very specific, like installing an operating system library in the container just to access to some specific content or whatever, no? It's I don't know, something that is not covered. We will see what they are covering. This the standard runtimes or the language runtimes, and when we will use the custom runtimes for, again, other languages not covered here, or specific requirements in terms of the operating system configuration or some libraries or whatever that you may need to be present that is not covered either by the standard environment or the flexible environment. So now we cover the second step. Let's start a little bit first of all how to create the application. Is very simple. If you had what I told you before, you need a Google Cloud project, the App Engine application activated, and the billing account. So if you already had the Google Cloud project, you had already the billing account connected, so this is already done, and the only thing that you need to do, this is done. If you had the account and the project created, you want to create a specific project just to contain the Google App Engine, you can create it and you can run it. When you can have as much as project as you want here, you can have you see here you I have different one, different IDs. So it's not a problem to create an additional project just to cover this service. And after that, you just run Google App Create. You can take a look to the. Let me show you here. I think it's here. Let me one second. It's you just execute Google Cloud. No, Google App Create. And sorry, Get Cloud. Sorry, Get Cloud App Create, and you follow the wizard. The question is, as I already had one, it is an error. To have additional, I had already created a Google App Engine application, so you can associate it to the main service principal account. So if you want to create, if you have that configuration as you didn't create it before, you can run it without any problem. It's just a matter to create to pass a couple of parameters. But if you and as you can see here, there is just a number of parameters. You can, but again, it's just running. I cannot run it again. I just will need to create as you can see here, you just follow the wizard. It's just provide the region and if you want to create a second one, you need to provide a service account. It has here, you can see on the documentation, it's that one. You can set up the second account with the. With specifying the URI of your new service account. So the billing is already, in case that you already have the project, is already created, you just need to link it. And then, well, again, very simple to do this, two clicks, and that's all. You can do it as well. So I recommend you to install the Google Cloud CLI because this will allow you to manage your Google account from your local environment using the command line interface, and it's pretty easy to use. It just follow the instructions, and you can do everything from that. No problem. You also can do it via API or via console using the cloud shell. If you are logged into the cloud, you can go here and do it as well there. But this what you have here is exactly the same that you had in your local computer if you install the CLI, Google CLI. Okay, once you have done, you need to decide, you already decide your language because you already had your application, and then you can choose in between two environments, the standard one or the flexible one. The standard is essentially an environment which is a template that you can choose. It's a pay-as-you-go. You can choose any one of these languages. There is no .NET here, and also you have to choose one of the instances that you want to use as infrastructure. There is some limits. You can take a look the limits of memory, the limits of CPU, and it is possible to scale or not to scale. And also you probably if you don't say anything, it's going to be deploying 1 GB of data storage. It is for a very small service is more than enough. If you are not running a model in this inference point, it's really more than enough. So all these services can be scheduled. You can expose a service, or also you can this service also can act based on events. So You know probably the technology pops up in Google also when the event hub, no, similar concept that what the Azure had with the service event hub. When you receive an event, you can trigger some application that is running in App Engine. So, and also it can be run via a schedule with a Chrome in a Chrome's in an schedule. It can be also done like this. It's not the usually what you do is expose something like the thing I did, and you can interact with it dynamically with the application that you expose in a public IP address, as you will see now. Okay, so this is the standard, but it is a simple application. You can choose this. Again, it's a very kind of a little bit restricted in the things that you can do, but for small things, for small applications, it can work, no? You don't need to worry too much. You just create your code. Just imagine that you just want to route some messages or filter some messages that you receive from PubSub and send it to I don't know, to a model, or to send it to a data lake. You can use a small service and a standard service in your favorite language or one of the available here, to deploy this application and have it ready to go. At the same time, you can interact as well with a small application with this querying. You will see later querying I don't know, a model, which is in an endpoint, deployed somewhere else. You can do many things. But the only restrictions, first of all, you don't have .NET and you cannot use custom environments here. Secondly, there is some limitations on the resources that you can apply to the application. So that's why you have here as well which one, the criteria to choose a standard or a flexible one. You can see the standard you can run for free, but obviously if somebody gives you something for free, it's not it comes with some how to say restrictions. You see here the management of the traffic is more rudimentary when in sometimes even not possible. In the when you have the flexible environment, you can choose any programming language. You can use native code in your framework. You can at the end of the day you are creating a Docker, and when you create a Docker, you can do whatever is possible to run in a Docker, you can do in a flexible environment. So with this, I think I say everything that you need to know. And you have the much more flexible configuration when you use the flexible environment. I will show you how to use flexible environment with Python in two modalities. One is the standard using Python. And the second one, doing a custom environment with a Docker file. So, custom runtimes and configuring. Yeah, okay. So, any environment, any application that you are going to deploy to App Engine need to have an App YAML file. It can be in this file, you define. Well, the infrastructure in few words, and also networking and accessing to other services via port forwarding. So there is well, you can at the deploying time you can choose which file you want to use for deployment. It's not you can it will try to find an app by default, an app.yaml file. But at deployment time with this command, we will see that later, you can choose the name of the YAML file that you want to use. And you can see pretty much is what you see here. The minimum you need is choose the runtime and the type of the environment, flexible or standard. And if you choose the standard, many of these things will be not available. Only this, look at the documentation of the standard service, which ones are available for you. In the case of flexible, you have the description. All these links I will pass you in the documentation. You can see the different YAML files depending on the application, depending on the what was custom is going, depending on the other one you want to which language you use, or even if you use the custom, we will cover these two, Python and custom. And okay, so this is the Git Cloud Ignore, is like the equivalent at the Git Ignore, but for these deployments in IPPNG. It's the exclusion files. Like the file that we use in the repository to exclude the file that we will post to the repo. So the minimum things that you need to, you can define variables like in any configuration file in Docker or in any other technology. The runtime, very important, it had to be Python or any of the languages. You can go to the other languages to check what is the specific nomenclature. In the case of the runtime configuration, in case that you want to use a Python above 3.8, you need to specify runtime configuration. Is not, by default, is installing a Python 3.7 with the bindings to Python 2.9, and if you are not aware of that, your application may not work. So you can check here the operating systems available and the runtimes available as well. So if you want to use, in the case I will show you, I'm using 3.11, and to do anything about 3.7, so from 3.8 onwards, you need to use Ubuntu 22 and the Python version in the runtime version. So environment type flexible had to be there, and then on the entry point that you will use to access your applications. As I say, you can use the specify the service accounts you will use on your service. You can have multiple services, multiple service accounts. You can specify as well here in the YAML file. Skip files is the concept of the same that Git ignore, which files you don't want to be deployed into the cloud. No? Then you have network settings, where you have the session affinity. This is the sticky cookie, the sticky bit. To especially when you are working with HTTPS, you need to have this activated. Well, IP parameters and forwarding ports parameters, in case that you want to communicate with other services inside the application. You have as well Unicorn. Okay, yeah, firewall. So you can have here, you can use as well. There is firewall rules here that you can apply. Well, this is very, very extensive and configuration that you can combine either defining in the YAML file and later on the console. And then on infrastructure, or the size of the machine that you want to use, you can use also. Parameters to you can specify parameters for health checks, liveness checks, readiness checks, and scaling, automatic scaling or manual scaling. So you can define, as you can see, everything that is related to the infrastructure in a single file, and you once you can change it anytime and make a new deployment. And the only thing that you need to take into account is the quotas, that you had enough services allocated to your account or to your project in order to run what you want. Here, you cannot use GPUs, so keep in mind you cannot deploy here probably a model. This is not the type of services prepared for that. What you are going to see here. So you can see here, not allowed to use GPUs, only CPUs. So, well, I'm not saying that you're not deploying a model. You can deploy a model which doesn't need a GPU. For example, a logistic regression model is perfectly possible. But if you plan to use APPNG to deploy a transformer or an LLM, this is not the technology to do it. There is other files. Chrome YAML is to run this under a Chrome configuration, and there is other the other two you can take a look is also for the making the service react when or be triggered when they receive an event. And yeah, there also some HTML configurations that you can specify if you have that specific requirement. So let's move to the code, and I will explain you essentially how it is done. Okay, so here on the prepare an application is well, the application it doesn't really matter. It's simply we are going to do two kind of deployments. One is using the Python runtime with the environment flexible. You pass an entry point. In this case, I'm going to run an application in Streamlit. I'm pointing to this Python script as a main page, and always you have to specify the port 8080. Why? Because in front of us, in front of this endpoint, is gonna be an application firewall or a reverse proxy, the type NGINX, and all the traffic that you direct to the port 80 or 443, HTTP or HTTPS, or the public IP address of this endpoint will be redirected to the port 8080 in this container. So always use 8080 if you are using Streamlit, Flux, whatever you are using to expose your application, have to be listening on the 8080 port. Then on, I'm using Python 3.11 for these applications. Therefore, I need to set up a runtime configuration and with Ubuntu 22 and the Python version. And for that application, is you probably know when you are using Flux, FastAPI or Streamlit essentially use FastAPI. So you need to set up the session affinity bit to keep control of the sessions, because here everything will be encapsulated in HTTPS, and then on the service need to know to which user return the information. At the end of the day, with this service can interact possible to interact multiple users at the same time, and doing that the application server notes who is sending what and to who to send the appropriate response, no? It's just matching the users with sessions. And with this is enough. You can specify the other parameters. It's not the application is gonna take by default. And with that, you have the minimum that you need to deploy an application in with the Python runtime. Apart of that, what you need the requirements TST. As I mentioned you before, this is gonna create a Docker, and the process is gonna be like if you are familiar with Docker technology, it will use a let me show you. It will create a an it will pull an image from Google, in this case from the Google repository GRC, Google repository, I don't remember what is the C, GCR is the name, the acronym. And it will take the image, it will be the base image, and in top of that it will install the requirements that you specify in your requirements TST. If you had this image is not going to be touched, so it's just pulling the image and installing the requirements. And after that, expose the entry point. Then simple as that. You look at the a Docker file. This is the one that we will use later on. The thing that the only three sentence or statements that this process are gonna use is from an image in Google Cloud. Depending on the runtime that you specify, it will use one or another. Secondly, it will do a pip install requirements and a copy of the software, and then on expose the endpoint that you specify right here. That's it. So if you need to do something apart of that, or you have a specific requirement in terms of libraries, when I mean in terms of libraries, mean that, for example, like here, you need to install a dependency like this, like click Poplar, or something that is not not part of the conventional Ubuntu deployment, something that is particular to your environment, something that you only have, you need to create a Docker file. And then it is not a case, you just simply can do that, set up the requirement files, and ready to go. Here the Google will decide the template is using one by default. In this case, for the moment, I don't care too much. It's just testing in case that the service is not it's not correctly dimensioned. I will choose something more specific in case that I need more memory. I will show you anyway later how to monitor how much memory, hard disks, etc. are spent in your application. So now, once you have this ready, you can see here as well, I have a repository. The name is Gemini Boot. And then I have my files, some other files here, the keys to access the service, my app Yammer file, and my requirements.txt. Once you have everything done, you just need to execute get cloud app deploy. Again, if you want to deploy with a specific service account, you nominate the service account here. If not, it will take the default and does it. You will see here, these parameters, you can choose them during the deployment creation process. So the address that you provide is the name of your project and the region, and then on everything ending in appspot.com. Okay, you just hit yes, and you will see that now the first thing that it will do is is copying the files here. There was only one change. This service is already running in App Engine, so if you change other files, then on it takes the image. You can see here it's taking this image from the GCR. This is the repository in Europe. Yeah, and now it's creating the Docker. It's exactly that. It's creating a Docker, and if you are familiar with that, you will see now it's taking it's installing the requirements. You can see here installing the requirements and blah blah blah. You probably are familiar with all this stuff. As you also know, after one deployment, Docker is clever enough or has us intelligent that if some of the layers are not changing, is reusing the layer from a cache and is not building it again. So in this case, I suppose that as I didn't include anything, this is going to be very fast. And then once the image is ready, it's going to be deployed automatically as new endpoint into the service. So yeah, the upgrade took 39 seconds, and I will take a little bit more to is deployed to the now exporting, and yeah, well, still creating the Docker. that later is going to export there. Let me show you something. What is going to happen here? So we are creating a new version. So now I had this in production. Now it's creating this one. It will be a moment that if we include this on the service, and once both are running at the same time, it will remove this from service. So here you can see here that split traffic. This is sometimes very interesting functionality that allow you to split the traffic across different versions. Different versions of your application. You can do this based on IP address, based on cookies, or randomly, and then you decide how much traffic you split among the different versions. You can simply add a version here. You add the traffic that you want to route to this version, and that's it. So let's check what's going on here. Still now the build is done. Now it's pushing, and we are updating the service default. The service default, as you see here, is the service I have created here. Okay, it's gonna take some minutes. I will pause when it's done. I will be back and I will show you the rest. Okay, this is done. Now you can see here that the service was deployed to this and is exposed to this URL. You can either click here or execute gcloud app browse. You can also stream the logs of your application, the logs that you will see later on. I will explain you as well how to see the logs of the default login of the application. And well, let's check how this is done. You can see here the application itself. Yeah. So with this, or you already had the application, and then on now you can interact with it. And then, so one of the problems we usually had using these technologies is, well, once you have it on the endpoint, you are kind of blind, no? You don't know what's going on, and well, if something happens, if there is an error, you probably may see on the application a problem or not, depending how you build it or which technology you are using. Many cases you are blind, no? And then on here, let's check now what we have deployed. This is the latest deployment that we just did. Yeah, so we had two instances running. So here probably now is there is still the two previous ones and the new two. It's gonna take some while to remove the other two containers that we had for the previous version. So you see here there is still, yeah, it's been stopped. As I mentioned you before, the previous one is been stopped. It's still contain two, and this, well, is the way that is the service is ensuring that you always access to your applications when you are switching from application to application. In any case, this is the one that we had available. You can check here the configuration of your application, how was deployed, automatic scaling, number of instances, the liveness. What we are using, the readiness check, liveness check, automatic scaling, AP version, runtime, Python, service account use, and settings. And also you can check the logs that the automatic monitoring and this readiness service, health service, etc., is automatically logging on the Google Cloud Observability Centers. This is a central login system that they have Google. That's just to collect everything that happened in all the services that you have activated. If you click on here, you will see that it's already doing a filter, okay, to just show you the logs related to that specific instance. But even on that, on this case, the number of the logs that are producing because of this readiness check, take a look, is every one every second, just readiness, many things. So to the book logs here is sometimes very complicated. So I will show you some tricks to you do case that you want to. You can set up, install the application, or sea, the library Google Cloud Login, and this allow you programmatically create login that logs that later are that you can visualize in here in the observatory. And then how I usually do is I don't is just I will explain you how I usually do this, and I explain. And I try to keep under control and understand as much as I can what happened when the application is running in the endpoint. And then using, in this case, Google Cloud Login, and you just create a credential and create a client, like you can see here. Don't worry, I will give you all this stuff later on the repository. And then on once you have the client, you can set up the client, and this doing that way is going to capture everything that you log with the login library, the conventional login library in Python, and it will be forwarded directly to the login capabilities in Google. Here I will show you an example. I'm going to produce, this is not needed, I'm going to produce an exception. And then what I usually do is put something that allow me to identify the page, whatever. Something to allow me to identify easily attack, to understand easily, for example, in which page, which script in Python I am. No? This is one of the ways I do it. And then I also prepare this small function, which essentially when an exception is produced on your application, it's capturing the system stack and is transforming this information into a string. And what I send to the login is essentially this, which will give me the type of the exception that was produced. And the component the which writes the section together with the script and the line that produce it. So here I'm going to provoke an exception. I divide by zero. This is going to produce an exception. I will capture, and then on you will see this exception produced in the login repository, in the login facilities. Just you produce it. Your application continue, and you can check now. If you just filter, you just can take this tag. You can put this or whatever is something that allow you to identify easily the applications. Here I did for the previous video I upload in Spanish. I did the same. That was, and you can see here. You already had, and then it's telling you zero division error. This is all the information that you need. You probably know that, no? This error was produced in the main script. That was produced in some of the libraries, and you will receive all the information of nested information of the error. No, there is a call in that module that is coming from that call in this module, and so on and so forth. It's going from the most general to the most particular, as the same error that you see on the console when something happens when you are running an application. This way, you can debug, or at least keep under control. If something happens, you just need to check if the tag that you use, I will show you how I did it in that application, was triggered, and you can find the logs on the login repository in Google. How I did in the application? Pretty simple. Let me show you the other, exactly that one. So I did here, first of all, in HPage in Streamlit, just in the main of the application, I enclosed everything, all the logic in a try state. And then when something happens inside the application, I just log in and I just send. This is how I do it. No? I take the system stack and I print it to the login capabilities in Google. In the middle of the application, I just put some information to understand where the application or what the application is going on, is doing. No? This way you can see, just do it the login you define at the beginning. The create the login setup, we create the login without credentials, we capture the login facilities in local, and we send it to Google. Now let's see how it works. Let me show you an example. Where is the application? It is here. So if we take from file, for example, this is data, we are going to take whatever, this one. It doesn't matter what the application is done, I just want to show you how I'm preparing a video to explain. Oops, here is not working. Oh yeah. Yeah, suppose 1 second. Leave me 1 second. Yeah, the problem is the application is still in deployment. You can see here that still we have 4 pods. Still is not being removed. Still doing some stuff in the background. But anyway, we will do some tests to show you how the information is going to be logged. And then on, let's whatever. It's just a way to show you how the application works, and later monitor the logs into the. Okay, now terminar. So now we can go. I was using the single page. 1 second. This is that one. That one. So in the one page, one doc, I had this Gemini one page tag. So I will check now which logs I have in the logs. So you can check here. Here is choosing all. And now you can check here. Gemini page run query. So you will see here all the logs that you are logging. And again, if you have it a section is producing, you just need to set up or set up if you have the same tag in the page where is which I it is how I'm having. You will see here not you have only info. Severity info in this query. We are in this application, so if you see an error, it will be something that is reflected here as well. And this way, at least you had probably more control of what's going on your application. And well, I don't know in your experience, in my experience, it's quite complex sometimes, especially when the applications are running in services like this to understand what's going on. The applications, well, it's by definition, I think, have problems, so it's something that you cannot avoid, even if you are the best developer in the world. There is many things that you even not control. A version will change, and or is not working exactly as expected in with the combination of some of the libraries. You cannot control that. No, in this case, and when you are running application in a service like this, there is something similar as well in Google, in Amazon, or in Microsoft Azure. When you are working with these technologies, to the book and to understand what exactly going on is really complicated. I give you some, well, insights of how I'm doing. Maybe it's helpful for you. It's not well. It's just wanted to show you how I do it, no, and how I work with these applications, which sometimes, again, in my opinion, is really complicated to work with. Okay, and that's all. Thank you very much for watching. I will be preparing some other videos. I'm preparing now the video of how I'm building this application, which is a bot, which is using Gemini Pro 1.5. It's a bot. It's an application which you send you some documents. It analyzes the documents, and you can make queries online about the documents that you upload to the cloud. I'm using App Engine to deploy the service and to make the service available to the users. And then I will make the video later on once it's a little bit more mature. I'm just finishing. In a couple of days, I will be preparing this stuff, and I will show you end to end how to make the application, interact, make the chat, transform the documents, etc., etc. And well, you can take a look to those videos. And well, you just watching this, you probably will have a part of the stuff I will be preparing or explaining in the following videos, and you will have all the information to create your own machine learning applications in Google Cloud. And that's all. Thank you very much for watching. As I used to say, well, if you are not subscribed, subscribe to the channel. Give me a like if you like the content and you think is interesting and useful for your job or for your training, and share with other colleagues or friends if you think that they can be useful for them as well. And this way, you help me to promote the channel and to grow in YouTube. Thank you very much, and see you soon.